Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome. Welcome to our online audience as well. It's always good to have you with us.
Good day. Beautiful day. Glad you all took the time to join us. Good to see you at a full house on Sunday morning. I'm sure you probably noticed there's still some work going on around. That's why we have our lights are down, and we've still got some repair work that we'll be doing. A lot of that will be done when the folks from Midland Valley arrive on the 11th of May.
We appreciate, before you know it.
Yeah, we appreciate all those who are hosting them while they're here, and in the next week or so we'll be having some meetings about some things that we'll need to do while we're here, and asking some of you to take care of some things. So watch for that.
Yeah, absolutely. We have a lot of meals to make, and we have some transportation projects, and so we'll need your help, and we'll let you know. The only real announcement is, we're having our Wednesday night and our Thursday Common Ground this week, so be sure to join us. And then tomorrow, Pastor Steve and I will be in Uddingston. There's a ministers meeting for our district, so it's the ministers on our district are getting together, and we'll fellowship together, and we'll pray together, and it'll just be a good time of renewal for everyone. So if you would just kind of keep us in your prayers for travel, and that we would be able to just enjoy the day.
It's always a good time because we get to worship and we get to be part of a congregation. So that'll be
really nice. We're excited about that. Okay, I think that's all our announcements. Leslie, would you pray for us, please?
Lord, we just thank and praise you that we're here today. We thank you for every single person who's come to our church today. And we pray, Lord, that we would worship together, we would feel your presence, and we would just enjoy being in your presence this morning. We pray for Pastor Steve as he ministers. Help us to take something really special home from today. Thank you for your presence, in Jesus' name.
Amen. Oh, it's good to be in the house of the Lord this morning.
Thank you. should actually jump in just there, honestly. About 1997, I saw an advert in a newspaper and it said Drummond Cash is playing Brett. And I phoned Teresa and I said, we need to go and see Drummond Cash Brett. And he sang that song. And there were probably 2,000 people in the audience. Huge audience, Brighton Centre, massive audience. And he came on, but Glenn Campbell was the supporting artist, which is really weird. But he came on, he said, my name's Jack Cashew. And he opened with that song. I swear to God, 2,000 people, maybe 20 people walked away and found Jesus. Because you know his story, you know, his crazy life. But when you play it, you just felt it.
Yeah.
And so just when people walk away,
finishing wine, then there's nothing like it was to be.
Well, you gotta have faith, seeking understanding. Talking about faith, seeking understanding. There's work to do, but it isn't too demanding. When you've got faith and you're seeking understanding.
What a remarkably appropriate song. Now, tomorrow morning, Pastor Tasha and I are going to be traveling, as she said, to the Nazarene Church in Uddingston. That's the one across the street from Tonic's Tea Cake. It always smells like chocolate in the area around the church, which is pretty wonderful. I don't know if you'd ever get tired of that, but anyway, that's how you know when you're close to the church, is when you smell the chocolate. So. But we're going there tomorrow for a district ministers gathering, and it's an all-day event. Starts at 9:30 in the morning, and it's going to be an early start for us. And we have to be there, or at least I do anyway, because I'm teaching four workshops, four classes. And I've been preparing to teach these workshops for several months, almost a year now, and we are pretty excited about them. Ask that you would pray for us, that all goes smoothly, and get there in time and everything, and that it's a blessing to those who attend. You know, a few days ago, I figured I better make sure we had a way to get to Uddingston, and since we still don't drive, I know we're working on it. We have a date for our practical test, and we'll be on the road soon, but we're not yet, so I figured I better check the train schedule. And I went to, Scott Rail website, and I put in my information, said we needed to travel from Largs to Uddingston, and we needed to be there by 9:15 on a Monday morning. And I found that we could either leave Largs at 6:35 in the morning, no thank you, or we had a choice. We could also leave at 7:23 a.m. That's a little better, but not much. Which would get us to Uddingston at 9:04, almost 2 hours later. And then we'd have to get from the train station to the church. And I was going to be carrying with me probably about 20 textbooks and my laptop and some other things. So I thought about that. And I talked with Tasha about it. And she suggested that maybe we ought to take a taxi. It would be quicker and more convenient to take us right to the church. You know, logistics are Pastor Tasha's forte. She knows how to get things done, how things ought to be done. But what became painfully apparent to me once again was not only that we had a couple options for how we could get there, but also that until we're able to drive, we have to rely on one of those other options. We are unable to make that trip by ourselves. We require the assistance of somebody else to get us there, and without their help, we are stuck. And it is not a pleasant thought to think that we're stuck without them. It's embarrassing and frustrating to be so dependent, especially for a couple of Americans. You know, we had it hammered into our head because we were raised that it is good to be independent and self-reliant. But sometimes we get stuck. Sometimes we find that we cannot move without some assistance. We find that there seems to be no way to get where we want to go in and of ourselves. You know, when we travel, we sometimes find ourselves stuck. We've been at Heathrow because our flight was canceled. We got stuck there. You probably know what that's like as well. Maybe you've been stuck in some other place because the train was canceled. Sometimes we hit an obstacle and can go no further. You know, a few weeks ago, we talked about how after the crucifixion, the disciples also huddled in fear behind locked doors because they were afraid. Their fear and anxiety trapped them in that place. They were stuck. I guess many of us, maybe most of us, have, if not all of us, have at some point, or we will, feel stuck, paralyzed. Like we don't know the way to go, or we just can't get going. Like we're in a place we'll never get out of. We talked on Wednesday night about how the disciples in that boat during that storm in Mark 4 asked Jesus if he cared that they were perishing. They said, "Don't you even care that we are stuck in this boat with a storm and there's no escape?" They cried out for deliverance from a place they didn't want to be and saw no way out of. And you may remember what Jesus said to them in Matthew's gospel. He said, "Why are you afraid, you of little faith?" Last week we talked about the difference between little faith, the Greek word was oligopistos, and faith like a mustard seed. And you'll remember Jesus makes that distinction in Matthew 17 when he tells the disciples that they couldn't work this one particular miracle because of their little faith, their oligopistos. But he tells them if they had faith like a mustard seed, nothing would be impossible. And we discovered that Jesus wasn't just talking about the size of faith, the amount of faith, but its ability to grow and to progress. Its openness to mature and to develop and expand. The difference between faith like a mustard seed and oligopistos is that oligopistos, little faith, is stagnant and dormant. It's stuck. It is paralyzed. And this morning, we're going to continue to seek an understanding of faith in this sermon series. We're going to think about a story in which Jesus does something very different from what we saw him do last week. Because last week, when he spoke to those disciples in that boat in the storm, he asked those disciples, just depending on which gospel you read, "Have you no faith?" Or, "Where is your faith?" Or he said in Matthew that they had that little faith. But today is a different situation. In the passage of scripture we're looking at today, Jesus takes notice of someone's faith. He sees it and recognizes it, and it leads him to action. Because of this faith that he sees, he does something, something remarkable, something that has never been seen before. We find the story that's known as Jesus healing the paralytic. In all three of the Synoptic Gospels, it's in Matthew's Gospel in chapter 9, verses 1 through 8. And it's in Luke's Gospel in chapter 5, verses 17 through 26. And the passage that we'll be looking at this morning, it's found quite early in Mark's Gospel, at the beginning of chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. Now, in Mark's Gospel, not a whole lot has happened when we get to the beginning of chapter 2, when we get to these verses. Jesus hadn't called all of his disciples yet. He calls Matthew in all three synoptic gospels right after this scenario. But in Mark's gospel, we're only one chapter in. And in chapter 1, Jesus was baptized, and then he was tempted out in the wilderness, and then he calls some fishermen to be his disciples. And he's done some healing and some preaching in Galilee. He healed a leper, and he told him, he said, "Don't tell anybody." And he didn't do that. He went out and told everybody. And because of that, word has spread, and lots of people want to see and hear Jesus. And that's the situation when we reach the beginning of chapter 2. Let's read, beginning with verse 1. When Jesus returned to Capernaum after some days, it was reported that he was at home. So many gathered around that there was no longer room for him, not even in front of the door. And he was speaking the word to them. So the word is out. Jesus is back in town. He's not hanging out in the countryside anymore. Mark tells us that Jesus is at home. But he's not home alone. Not by a long shot. Mark tells us there are so many people gathered there, inside and outside that house, that there was no room left. You know, our sanctuary feels a little bit like that sometimes. But this was even more crowded. There was no room left anywhere. You couldn't even get to the front door to get in. And Mark tells us that Jesus is speaking the word to them. He's preaching. He's proclaiming the good news and calling on folks to repent and to believe. All right, so that's the scene. That Mark has set the scene for us. And now some action happens. The plot develops. Verse 3. Then some people came, bringing to him a paralyzed man, carried by four of them. And when they could not bring him to Jesus because of the crowd, they removed the roof above him, and having dug through it, they let down the mat on which the paralytic lay. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Now here we arrive at the crux of this passage and the crux of this sermon. Mark tells us that some people show up. Now Luke tells us this too, and so does Matthew. None of them say how many there are, but Mark tells us that four of them are carrying someone else, a paralytic, someone who has limited mobility, who in some way is unable to move because of weakness or some lack of motion, lack of range of motion. But this paralyzed man is moving because he's being carried by these four others. Now, neither Mark nor the other gospel writers tell us much about this man or his four carriers. We don't know their names. We don't know their relationship. They may be related. They may be family members. They may be friends. It's even possible that they could be strangers. We don't know, because the gospel writers don't tell us. But what we do know is that this man is being carried to Jesus. We don't know if he asked these others to help him. We don't know if they told him they were going to bring him. All we know is that they have come to this place carrying this man. They may have traveled for a very long time. We don't know. But now they have arrived, and there is a problem, an obstacle. There is such a crowd gathered there, made up not only of people in general, but of the scribes. Luke tells us scribes and Pharisees, teachers of the law who are keeping an eye on Jesus' activities. There is such a crowd that these people and their passenger, the burden that they're bearing, they can't get in to see Jesus. Now don't miss the point here. Sometimes people can get in the way of someone who's trying to come to Jesus. Sometimes people do it unintentionally. Sometimes people do it intentionally. And I don't ever want to be one of them, and I hope you don't either. And Mark tells us they could not bring him in because of the crowd. There was an obstacle that threatened to put an end to their journey. And Mark doesn't tell us that any of these people said anything, but I imagine there must have been some conversation between them. And I just wonder if the paralyzed man didn't say to his carriers, "Listen, I appreciate you bringing me this far, but there's no way in. We're stuck." And this paralyzed man knew what it was to be stuck. Without the assistance of this entourage, he'd have been stuck back wherever he was to begin with. But they had brought him this far only to be hindered, to be stuck just close enough to see their destination, but not close enough. And I just wondered if one of these folks who were carrying him didn't say, oh no, we'll find a way, you just wait. They can't see it yet, but they will. You know, sometimes we have to go as far as we can go and then wait until we're shown a way to go a little further. And these people, these four carriers, this man's transportation, they see a way forward, but it involves a little work, a little demolition, or a little deconstruction, if you might say. You know, Pastor Tasha and I have done some renovations before to some houses and to buildings at our Urban Farms campus. And a lot of times when you do renovations, when you make something new, you got to do some demolition first. And I don't mind telling you, I love doing demolition. Demo work, we call it. Tearing down walls and ripping up floor coverings and pulling cabinets and toilets and bathtubs out. I even had and still have a favorite crowbar. This is my favorite crowbar right here. I'm using it in those photos there. This will tear some stuff apart, let me tell you. It is ergonomically designed. That's why I brought it all the way over here with me. So, need anything tore up, you let me know. I got my crowbar. I hope when Midland Valley gets here, we can do a little tearing things up. But thing about demolition is it's not for everyone. It can get loud and messy and even dangerous. That's not red paint there. That's blood. That's my blood on that floor right there. But demolition is the solution that these folks carrying this paralyzed man come up with to solve the problem that they're faced with. They decide that tearing the roof off of this house that Jesus is teaching in is the answer to their predicament. Dismantling this structure where Jesus is contained and that restricts access to him is the path they choose to take. They don't tear down the whole house, of course. They just deconstruct enough to make a way where there was no way, to allow one who was prevented from coming into the presence of Jesus to find his way there, to see that the one who was stuck on the outside finds himself on the inside. You know, sometimes there are structures in place that prevent folks from getting to where Jesus is, that keep them at a distance, that keep them on the outside and don't allow them inside. And those structures deserve to be dismantled, to be deconstructed, to be demolished. But what, we might wonder, does Jesus have to say about all this, about all this demolition? Jesus is trying to preach the word to these people. He's teaching about the good news. And here come these people tearing through the roof. Now, you know this was no inconspicuous act. Demolition is loud and messy and dangerous. They'd have caused a commotion tearing through this structure. Imagine the dust and the noise and the light suddenly tearing through the, beaming through that hole in the top of the house while Jesus is trying to teach. While Jesus is trying to preach. I can't help but think how I might feel. Somebody raised such a ruckus during one of my sermons, I might have a problem with it. You might think that Jesus would too. You might think that he would raise his voice and ask these guys what in the world they think they're doing. He's trying to preach and they're interrupting and destroying property. Mark tells us this is where Jesus lives. Why, he ought to call the cops. At least he ought to make them fix that roof. You know it's going to leak. Rain and the wind and who knows what else is going to get in. They not only cause a commotion and make a mess, but they also crowd the house more than it already was. But do you know what Jesus says about all their demolition and dismantling and deconstruction? Not one word. He makes no mention of it whatsoever. It is as if it is so insignificant and appropriate as not even to warrant pointing out. Apparently, it's not a problem. Apparently, it is not an inappropriate or problematic response to the situation. And not only does Jesus make no mention of it in Mark and Luke's gospel, but in Matthew's gospel, Matthew doesn't even say anything about the house and the roof or any of that. Now, Mark doesn't tell us that when Jesus saw the mess, they made him angry. He doesn't tell us that when Jesus heard the racket they made, he rebuked them for disturbing his sermon. No. Mark simply tells us this in verse 5. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven." When Jesus saw their faith, not his, but their faith. When Jesus sees and recognizes and acknowledges their faith, he says to the paralyzed man, "Son, son," he calls him, "your sins are forgiven." Now, of course, the word for faith here is that familiar word we've learned about. The word is pistis, the word that empowers Thomas to acknowledge Jesus as my Lord and my God. The faith that the disciples in that boat on those stormy seas do not have. But these folks do. And Jesus sees it. Jesus recognizes it. And because of the one who was stuck outside, because of that faith, the one who was stuck outside has been brought inside. Not just physically into this place where Jesus is, but spiritually as well. Jesus declares that his sins have been forgiven when he sees their faith. Jesus declares that he has been forgiven because of his faith and the faith of the ones who brought him. And make no mistake, without these four who carried him, this paralyzed man would still be stuck and mired down by guilt and shame and sin. But they weren't having it. Their faith drove them to act, and his faith drove him to let them. Now, this is the first time in Mark's gospel that faith, pistis, has been mentioned. It's also the first time that sins have been forgiven. Now notice that Jesus addresses this man's spiritual paralysis before he addresses his physical paralysis. Because until his sins are forgiven, this man can't move forward in his faith. This man can't grow in grace. He is stuck, paralyzed. But when he sees their faith, Jesus declares that this man's sins have been forgiven. And we might ask, what is it about their faith that Jesus takes notice of? What is it about their faith that prompts Jesus to declare that this man's sins have been forgiven? I think there are several things that we can point to. First of all, theirs is a faith that is not self-centered. It is not concerned primarily with their own needs, but with the needs of another. This one who is stuck, who's paralyzed, who is powerless in his own ability to come to the place where Jesus is. Secondly, theirs is a faith that bears the load. Bears the load. It takes on the burden that says to this man, if you can't get there, we'll carry you as far as it takes. Next, this is a faith that doesn't give up. It is a faith that makes a way where there is no way. Theirs is an active faith that takes action, even when that action is noisy and messy and might draw attention and disturb the order of things. Theirs is a faith that lifts up, that elevates the one that's carried and sets him down in the presence of Jesus. Theirs is a faith that brings another to a place of healing and forgiveness. Theirs is a faith that grants an opportunity for Jesus to demonstrate who he is. And finally, theirs is a deconstructive faith that does not hesitate to remove the barriers from the house in which Jesus resides when there are those who do not have access. And Jesus sees their faith. Let's look at this last section just briefly, beginning with verse 6. Now some of the scribes were sitting there, questioning in their hearts, "Why does this fellow speak in this way? It's blasphemy. Who can forgive sins but God alone? At once, Jesus perceived in his spirit that they were discussing these questions among themselves, and he said to them, "Why do you raise such questions in your hearts? Which is easier, to say to the paralytic, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or to say, 'Stand up and take your mat and walk'? But so that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, he said to the paralytic, 'I say to you, take up your mat and go to your home.' And he stood up and immediately took the mat and went out before all of them. So they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, 'We have never seen anything like this.'" You know, all three synoptic gospels mention the reaction of the scribes to Jesus' declaration that this man's sin is forgiven. Luke tells us there were Pharisees there as well, but I just want to think about for a moment about why they're so offended by this. They call Jesus a blasphemer. Jesus knows what they're saying and thinking. And he asks them, "Why do you raise such questions in your heart?" And I want to suggest that the questioning of these scribes and Pharisees, these religious leaders and experts in the law, is of a different sort from the kind of investigative curiosity that drove Thomas to place his hand in Jesus' wounds, or even the questions that the disciples raised on that boat when they were in that storm in the middle of the sea. Remember those questions? "Do you not care that we're perishing?" Then they ask, "What manner of man is this?" And I suggest that because these scribes are motivated by two things. First, they're motivated by a suspicion of Jesus. The Gospels are quite clear that the scribes and Pharisees are out to trap Jesus, to expose him as a fraud and a blasphemer. So that's what they call him here. And secondly, there's a reason that they're particularly upset with the forgiveness of this man's sin. And that's because the scribes are legal experts. They have made it their business to make sure that they and everybody else knows who is righteous and worthy and clean and who is sinful and unworthy and unclean. They are the gatekeepers of who is inside and who is outside. And quite literally, who is allowed inside the temple and who has to stay on the outside. And a man who is paralyzed is clearly unclean. You tell just by looking at him. He doesn't deserve to be an insider. He wouldn't have been allowed inside the temple. But at this house where Jesus is, these folks have torn off the roof to allow him to enter into Jesus' presence. This unclean, paralytic sinner. And it would almost certainly have been assumed that this man's sins had caused his affliction, that he got what he deserved. And for these experts in the law, that is as it should be. Transgression requires punishment. The books have to be balanced. That's just the divine order of things. Outsiders need to stay outside, and insiders need to stay inside. To quote one of my favorite musicals, that's the way it goes. Everybody knows that's the way it's always been and how it's got to be. Incidentally, the whole production of Hurley is on YouTube, and you can watch it for free. Make sure you watch the one with Robert Guillaume in it. It is a masterpiece. I think I'm going to watch it this afternoon. But here comes Jesus. Here comes Jesus telling this unclean outsider that his sins are forgiven, allowing him into the structure where the word's being taught, where the gospel's being proclaimed. And here's Jesus ignoring the mess his friends have made and the destruction they caused to the edifice that was designed to protect those inside from the things outside. Ooh, that's nothing short of blasphemy. But Jesus asked him, "Why you gotta be like that? I'm gonna show you something. What's easier, to say your sins are forgiven or to say rise up and walk? But since the only way you scribes will really know And that's the word Jesus uses, so that you'll know. He doesn't say to the scribes and Pharisees, so that you'll have faith, because he knows their hearts are not open to accept faith. So they'll know. They'll see. They'll perceive that Jesus has the authority to declare this man clean and sinless and worthy. He tells them, I say to you, stand up. Take your mat and go to your home. All these scribes, they don't like anybody forgiving sins, because sins are their method of control. Guilt is how they keep people in their place, by sticking a label on them and not letting them forget how shameful and worthless they are. You're unclean, and you always will be. You're stuck. You're not going anywhere. But Jesus says, Son, your sins are forgiven. You're not unclean anymore. You're clean. You don't need to be defined by your limitations anymore. Your identity isn't bound to the things that you've done or not done in the past. They're removed. They've been forgiven. Now get up and get moving. You got things to do. Mark tells us everybody sees him do just that. And they're amazed and they glorify God and they say, we have never seen anything like this. There is a simple point that I want to leave you with this morning. And it's a message for the church. Not just this church, but the church in general. And that message is this. We can choose to follow the example of the scribes and to act like gatekeepers. We can concern ourselves with evaluating who's clean and who's unclean, who the insiders are, and who needs to stay or be put outside, who's worthy and deserving, who isn't. We can make it our job to preserve and to strengthen the structures of exclusion that have been built under the false assumption that we need to hang on to what's out and make sure nobody gets their dirty little hands on it. Or we can follow the example of the four unnamed carriers in this story, those who were not deterred by the obstacles in their way, those whose deconstructive faith drove them to do whatever it took to bring the one in need, the one who was paralyzed, the one who was stuck, into the presence of Jesus. It could be this morning, and maybe you identify more with the one who is paralyzed. Maybe you feel like someone who is stuck in a moment you can't get out of. Maybe you can't imagine any way forward. Maybe you can't see how you could rise up and make progress and move toward your destination. Maybe you feel labeled by sin and guilt and shame, and you can't imagine getting clean. Now let me tell you this morning, don't give up. Talk to someone. Ask for help, because we're all in this together, and we're all called to a deconstructive faith that tears the roof off if it needs to.
Amen. That's right.
That removes the barriers, whatever they are. We're called to do what we can so that everybody can come into the presence of Jesus and have access to his teaching and forgiveness and healing. Let's not be afraid to answer that call. I'd like to ask our worship team to come on.
Speak the name of Jesus.
You are the body of Christ. And as you leave this place of worship, may you have the heart of Christ, tender for mercy. May you have the eyes of Christ to see a world in need. May you have the feet of Christ to bring the good news. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Amen.
Thanks for working with us this morning. We love you guys. Y'all have an awesome week.
Have some of those good tracks in the space right there. Anything else we have, we'll see y'all.